Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So let me start with a very basic question of what is a distributed algorithm? And the definition is actually very simple. If you think of a sequential algorithm as being an algorithm where the processes take steps one after the other, a distributed algorithm is an algorithm where the steps can be taken concurrently. For example, you can have many threads executing at the same time within a machine, or you can have many processes executing concurrently across multiple machines in the same network. So even though this definition is quite simple, it actually implies a lot of complexity when it comes to what the algorithms are actually doing and why they work, as we shall see in this lecture. But it also brings about, distributed algorithms also brings about many benefits. It allows better performance because once you have processes executing at the same time, you can parallelize your computation. It also allows you to have fault tolerance because if one of the process or one of the threads crash, the other ones can take over the computation that the first one was doing and continue from there. It also allows new applications where fundamentally you have multiple users using the system at the same time, and the only way for that to work is to have multiple processes executing at the same time. So you can think about, for example, a multiplayer game. You have the various players taking steps at the same time. Or if you think of peer-to-peer networks such as BitTorrent and so forth, you definitely have users that are sharing the files in the system at the same time. In this slide, I'm going to show some features and contrast the difference between distributed and centralized algorithms. And the first clear difference is, as I mentioned, by the definition, a centralized algorithm is one where the execution proceeds sequentially, and a distributed one is where the execution proceeds concurrently. Now, as a consequence, in centralized algorithms, because you have sequential execution, there is no need to coordinate the execution across several processes, because after all, there is only one process executing. But when you have a distributed algorithms with multiple processes, you have to be careful about how you orchestrate their steps. So for example, there might be cases where the first process needs to wait for the second process to accomplish a task before it continues. And that's called coordination. With centralized algorithms, there is no need for communication because there's only one process executing. But if you have a distributed algorithms, processes often have to exchange information with each other. With centralized algorithms, oftentimes you have no failures because you only have one process. If that process has a problem, all bets are off. But with a distributed algorithm, you have multiple processes executing, and each one may be subject to failures of different types, as we're going to see here later. Centralized algorithms tend to have a much smaller state space than distributed algorithms. And the reason for that is that with a distributed algorithm, the state space tends to be the product of the state space of each computing entity or of each process running in the system. And you can have multiple different interleavings of execution. And that tends to cause, if you look at the global state space, an explosion of the number of possible states that it can reach. And that explosion often means that there are certain states, if you're not careful, how you're designing algorithms, that may lead to anomalous behavior. Centralized algorithms are often intuitive because we tend to think sequentially. That's how our logic works. And distributed algorithms often escape intuition, and the reason being because multiple things are happening at the same time, and you often need a more rigorous treatment to understand why they work and what their performance is. And so, with centralized algorithm, correctness is often obvious, and this perhaps is an oversimplification. Of course, there are algorithms that are quite subtle and complicated. But for distributed algorithms, things are much, much more complicated. And a distributed algorithm includes a special case for one process can be executing a centralized algorithm where the complexity would be the same as that for the centralized algorithms. But when you have multiple processes executing at the same time, the correctness of such algorithms can be deceiving. With centralized algorithm, you can often apply linear reasoning to understand their behavior, whereas with distributed algorithms, you have to apply parallel reasoning. And finally, centralized algorithms are easier to implement and debug than distributed algorithms because with distributed algorithms, you have to consider the cases when, for example, if you're trying to debug such systems, where the various interleaving of the processes could be causing problems in your application. And if you want to debug these things, you may run into scenarios where you cannot reproduce the original interleaving that caused the problem. So this was an overall very high-level comparison between these two different types of algorithms. In this course, we're going to be looking at specific distributed algorithms. And I should mention that there are two types of distributed algorithms that people generally consider. The first type is message passing algorithms, which is going to be the focus of this course. And in this algorithm, processes communicate with each other by sending and receiving messages. And this is depicted by this picture here, where you see two processes, P and Q, and there is a communication link that allows process P to send a message to process Q and vice versa. The other type of distributed algorithm are shared memory algorithms, where processes communicate with each other by writing to a shared memory or a common location that both processes can access. An example of that would be a multi-threaded application that shares the memory. They write to the same address space, and what one process writes, the second process can read. Now, I've been using the word process, and in this slide, let me tell you a little bit more what I mean by a process. You can think of a process as being an abstraction of computation. So a process essentially is an entity that executes sequential code. So each process executes sequential code. But the parallelism or the distribution of the concurrency comes from the fact that there are multiple processes executing at the same time. So one process may communicate with others, as I mentioned in the previous slide, either using messages or using the shared memory. The process may receive inputs and produce an output to the external world. And this is usually used to model specific problems. So when you have, for example, a problem that you want to solve with a specific algorithm, you usually need to, one way to model the specific inputs that your problem has and the specific outputs that your problem has to produce. And the process basically communicates with the outside world using these inputs and outputs. And throughout this presentation, I'm going to denote processes using letters such as P, Q, R, and sometimes subscripted by numbers P1, P2, or Q1, Q2, and so forth. So processes may be subject to failures, and there are several different failures that we're going to consider: fail stop, crash, omission failures, or Byzantine failures. And when we design an algorithm that needs to tolerate such failures, we need to impose a limit on the number of failures, because if all the processes suffer failures, for example, all the processes crash, then there's going to be no hope for you to be able to solve the specific problem that you're trying to solve. Now, I mentioned that we're going to be focusing on message passing algorithms where processes can communicate with each other by sending messages. And the links are the abstraction that allows processes to communicate with each other. There are basically two types of links that one could consider: point-to-point links and broadcast links. So in point-to-point links, one process can send a message to another, and then subsequently the other process would receive that message. If you have broadcast links, a process could broadcast a message to several different destinations, and then some or all of the destinations may subsequently receive the message. And our focus here is going to be on point-to-point communication, though there are distributed algorithms that are quite interesting that also consider broadcast communication, especially when it comes to wireless networks, for example, mobile ad hoc networks, and so forth. And finally, when it comes to links, you can consider a system where each pair of processes can communicate with each other via link, or you may have a graph network that allows only some pairs of processes to communicate. And here, we're going to consider the case where every pair of processes can communicate with each other. So you can think of that as the communication graph being a fully connected network. And the reason why we can do this, we can make this assumption that we have a fully connected graph network, is that there are already very well-known and well-developed routing algorithms that, given an arbitrary communication graph that have sufficient connectivity, allows you to implement the abstraction where every pair of processes can communicate. So you can think of the internet, for example, where given any two IP addresses, you can send a message from one to the other as an abstraction where every IP address is connected to every other IP addresses. But if you look at the underlying communication, what's really going on is that the processes are sending these messages over physical links, and the messages are getting routed across several different network elements in the system. So here, we're just going to make the simplifying assumption that every pair of processes can communicate with each other via some underlying primitive. There's also the question of whether the communication links between processes is reliable or not reliable. If you have a non-reliable communication link, when a process sends a message, the message may be lost and never arrive. Or sometimes a process sends a message once, and the receiver may receive the message multiple times. Or in some really bad cases, you can have communication links that create spurious messages out of the blue. By contrast, if you have reliable communication links, processes that send a message, if a process sends a message to another one, the other process is guaranteed to receive that message eventually. So more precisely, reliable communication links are defined by these two properties here. First one being that if P sends a message to Q, then eventually Q is going to receive the message from P. And the other message says that Q does not receive spurious messages from P that P has never sent to Q. You had a question, Lorenzo? Do you want to use the mic?
I'm going to screen. Are you assuming that P and Q are correct?
Yeah, so there's a subtlety here of whether when you're considering correct processes, whether the receiver, if the receiver has some kind of failure, is not able to receive the message. And so I'm going to make the assumption that a process can receive a message even if the process has some kind of problem. And this is just an abstraction trick. But if you don't like that type of modeling, then you can just have a situation where you model a reliable link by saying, if both processes P and Q are correct and P sends a message to Q, then Q eventually receives the message from P. But you can think of being the protocol buffers or the messaging layer as being something separate from the fact that processes are crashing or not crashing. And when P sends a message to Q, Q is able to receive that message because the message is deposited into the buffer of Q, irrespective of the fact of whether Q has crashed or not. So our focus here is going to be on reliable links that satisfy these two properties. And the reason why we can make that assumption is that there are fairly well-developed data link protocols that take non-reliable links that can have message loss, duplication, or spurious messages, and converts that and implements the abstraction of a reliable link. So you can think of, for example, if you have a TCP connection between two processes, TCP will take care of retransmitting messages that get lost and so forth, and including checksums to make sure that if messages are corrupted, they're not received. So this slide shows a summary of the setting that we're going to consider. Here we see five processes, P1, P2, 3, 4, and 5. They're connected by these edges, which are communication links. And as you can see here, you have a fully connected communication network. We're making the assumption that these links are reliable, meaning if a process sends a message, the other one receives it, and so forth, as I mentioned in the previous slide. And I'm also showing here a message flowing from P2 to P1. So is it clear what the setting is? Because we're going to be plunging to the various distributed algorithms from now on. I define a lot of different terms, but now we're actually going to start looking at specific problems and specific algorithms. So do you want to use the mic to ask the question so it goes into the recording? Yeah, we're going to look at the various types of failures, but fail stop, crash failures, omission failures, Byzantine failures are all types of failures that want to consider. And when you design an algorithm, you usually have a specific type of failure that you want to address. And the fail stop is the simplest one, or the process simply stops executing and the other processes know about it. But we're going to look into more details at the various failure types soon. So this lecture is divided into two parts, which is going to be the first part given today, the second part given tomorrow morning. In the first part, we're going to look at synchronous systems, where processes execute at the same speed. The links deliver messages within a bounded delay. And in fact, if you have these two properties, you can assume that all the communication between processes occur in a round model that I'm going to define in my next slide. Now, tomorrow, we're going to look at asynchronous systems, where there are no bounds on the relative speed of processes, no bounds on message delivery times. And these algorithms tend to be significantly more complex. And sometimes you can't even have an algorithm to solve a given problem in such models. So the round model in the synchronous systems that we're going to consider, processes execute essentially one round at a time. So first, processes execute the first round. then the second round, and so forth. And in each round, a process sends a message to all the other processes, to the other processes, receives messages that were sent to other processes to it in the same round, possibly outputs a value, and this has to do with trying to solve a problem. And then at the end of the round, it changes states, and then it starts the next round. Now, that's the behavior of a process that hasn't failed. If a process fails, then it may fail to execute in that way. And so this time diagram shows exactly the behavior of four rounds, 1, 2, 3, and 4, in three processes. And so this is a timeline where time is flowing to the right. And you can see that at the beginning of round one, process P1 is sending messages to P2 and P3, process P2 is sending a message to P1 and P3, and process P3 is sending a message to P1 and P2. And the messages are being represented by the arrows here. So you can see that processes send messages at the end of the rounds, processes receive all the messages that were sent to it. What you cannot see is that the process will change state before it starts executing the next round. When it executes the next round, it just repeats the whole process. Yeah, the assumption here is that P1 sends a message within a round. All the messages that P1 sends will be received in that round. Now, P2 sends a message then in the first round. All the messages that P2 sends will also be received in that round. Now, this is a model. If you want to implement a model and you have physical links connecting processes, you need to have the property that the physical links have a delay which is bounded. Or, you know, if you're lucky enough to have all the delays being exactly the same, you can implement the model exactly as it is here. If the delays are not exactly the same, then you have to take the maximum delay in order to implement these rounds and choose that as being your round length. And so what would happen, for example, instead of having this figure where P1 sends a message and gets received at the end of the round, maybe gets received before the end of the round. But once you have bounded delays, you can implement this abstract model that basically tells you that in each round, you can think of all the processes sending messages to each other simultaneously and receiving messages from each other simultaneously. But in reality, yes, if you want to implement this model, you need to have bounded delays. But you don't have to have exact the same delays for all the processes.
Do the processes have to be notified till what's the maximum limit they have to wait for? Suppose if a process P2 receives a message before that delay, then he has to wait before further process.
Oh, absolutely. If you want to implement a model like this, you need to know ahead of time what is the maximum length that it can take for a message to arrive. So if you decide that that's going to be half a second, then you define the length of a round to be half a second. In all the processes, we're going to be waiting for half a second before they proceed to the next round. More questions? Yes. Well, so a boundary of a round is just, for example, if we assume that it's going to take 1 second for processes to finish a round, after 1 second, a process will automatically start the second round. So in other words, at time t equals 0 seconds, all the processes go and execute send messages to each other. And then they wait until time t equals 1, knowing that, for example, there is a maximum message delay of half a second. And so at time t equals 1, they have received all the messages that were sent at the beginning of the round. So at time t equals 1, they go and start executing the second round. So that would be the boundary between the first and the second round. I cannot hear you. Can you speak louder, please? Yeah. So absolutely. Now, in an idealized model, when a process is changing state, it's going to take some time for it to change state. For example, it may involve some computation that takes a while. You have to take that into consideration. What is the maximum time it's going to take for the process to change state? And make sure that all the processes are able to make that transition before they start the second round.
OK.
Application of this type of programming, can you give an example?
Yeah, so the various algorithms we're going to be looking at, such as consensus algorithms or broadcast algorithms and so forth.
Okay.
And so what I described now up to so far is one model where processes execute as expected, but you can have failures in a system. So you folks have asked, what is a fail-stop failure? And it turns out that there are several different failures that one could consider. And so the crash failure, when a crash failure occurs, essentially a process stops executing. And in the round where it stops executing, the process may not send a message to all the recipients. In fact, it may send a message to none of the recipients. Or the process may be lucky that it fails right after it was able to send a message to all the recipients. Or in some cases, the process crashes right in the midst of sending, and that causes some of the messages being sent to the recipients and some of the messages not being sent. And so in other words, when a crash failure occurs, the process stops executing, and only some subsets of the recipients of the messages in that round may receive the message that the process sends. Another type of failure is a send omission failure, where a process doesn't necessarily crash and stops executing. The process continues executing subsequently rounds. So if a process suffers a send omission failure, in that round, the process may fail to send a message to some of the recipients. But later on, the process will continue executing the subsequent rounds, and the process may no longer suffer a send omission failure, may continue execution sending messages to all the recipients. You can have a receive omission failure where some processes fail to receive messages sent to it in a specific round. You can have a general omission failure, which is basically the union of a send omission failure or a receive omission failure. In other words, the process fails to send a message to some subset of the process or fails to receive a message from some subset of the processes. And you can have Byzantine failures where processes fail to execute in the way that the algorithms tell them to execute. So if the algorithm, for example, tells the process sends a message M0 to all the other processes, or if the process suffers a Byzantine failure, the process may send a message that has nothing to do with what the algorithm said. And so here I have a set diagram that shows how these various different types of failures relate to each other. And you can see that the subset of crash failures you can think of being as the most limiting type of failure. And you can see that send omission failures and receive omission failures include crash failures as a special case. For example, for a send omission failure, you can have a situation where in every round, a process suffers a send omission failure and fails to send to everybody. Well, that is exactly like a crash failure where the process stops executing from that round on. And a general omission failure, as I mentioned, includes, as particular cases, send omission failures and receive omission failures. And Byzantine failures are the most general type of failures. For example, with the Byzantine failures, if the algorithm tells the process to send a message, the algorithm may simply not send the message. And that might look like a crash failure, because in a crash failure, the process basically stops sending messages to everybody else. This slide shows a depiction of the various failure types using the time diagram that I showed to you previously. And so the little X here shows a failure. So when you have a process crash, you can see that in the first timeline, let me see if I can get this to work. So process P2 has suffered a crash failure at the beginning of the second round. So this is the first round, this is the second round. And as a result of that, process P2 fails to send the message that it was intended to send to process P3, which is being shown by the dotted lines here. And you can see that with a crash failure, once a process has crashed, in this case in the second round, in all the subsequent rounds, the messages that P2 was intending to send to the other recipients are not included here, these messages. In other words, when a process crashes, the crash is permanent. In the second timeline, you see a send omission failure that occurs at the beginning of round 2 for process P2. And in this case, what happens is that P2 fails to send messages to the intended recipients P1 and P3, but continues executing. And you can see that in round 3 now, process P2 is just fine and sends messages to everybody. But then process P2 has another send omission failure in round 4 and fails to send a message to process P1. But it doesn't fail to send a message to process P3. So in other words, the nature of send omission failure is that a process succeeds to send to some subset of the intended recipients, but there can be still some processes that receive a message in that round. And the send omission failure is different from a process crash in the sense that in subsequent rounds, the process continues executing and may in fact be able to send a message to everybody. And here we see receiver mission failures where the process P2 has failed to receive the messages that P1 and P3 intended to send to it. And that has happened in round 2. And again, in round 4, we have a receiver mission failure where P2 just fails to receive a message from P1. But in round 3, process P2 is just fine and receives a message from everybody. Yeah, so the question is, in this time diagram, how do we differentiate between send mission failures and receive mission failures? And in particular, if you look over here, where, let's say, P2 is executing, right? So you can think of this as being not P2 having a send mission failure, but you can think of this as being P1 having a receive mission failure. At the same time, P3 is having a receive mission failure, and P2 is just fine. And the answer is, this is just how we model failures, right? So in reality, what is happening is that the message is disappearing from the send buffers. And so there are two ways for account for these messages. One way to account for this message is to say inside our heads and pretend, oh yes, the reason why this message is not there is because P2 has failed to send a message. The other way to account for such failure is the reason why the message is not there is because the recipient of P2's message didn't receive the message and had the failure. And so what we're going to do with these failures is actually design algorithms that will be able to tolerate a limited number of such failures. For example, there will be an algorithm that can tolerate T send omission failures. And so as long as the failure patterns look exactly like this, but there is only T of them, the algorithm will work. Now, whether you explain the failure because of a send omission or the failure because of receive omission is an orthogonal concern. As long as you're able to, given a time diagram, you're able to think of the failures as being occurred in a way that is consistent with send omission failures or send omission or receive omission failures, your algorithm will work. Does that address your question? Yeah, to be more specific, a given failure can be classified in two different ways, and algorithms will be constructed that is able to tolerate such failures. Oh, understood. Are we actually going to be considered for a specific algorithm only one type of failure? And so you pick an algorithm, you pick a failure model. It's going to be crash failure, it's going to be Byzantine failure, send omission failure, receive omission failures. The algorithm is designed to work for that model. So when you have an algorithm, you don't have two different failure types that the algorithm, or it may be the case that the algorithm works for multiple different failure types. But when you actually consider the execution of the algorithm, you just have one failure type in consideration. So what I'm presenting here is all the various options that you can pick as an algorithm designer when you're trying to come up with your algorithm.
Okay.
So let me start with how to deal with crash failures in synchronous systems. And the particular problem that we're going to be trying to solve is the consensus problem, in which processes start with some initial value, which can be different from process to process. And the goal is for all of them to converge on a single value. So processes must output or decide a value such that three properties hold. The first one being that no two correct processes decide different values. So in other words, all the correct processes need to decide the same value. The second property, which is called validity, says that if a process, correct process, decides some value, that value was the initial value of some process in the system. Because if you don't make that assumption, you can trivially solve the problem by making always processes decide on the value 0, irrespective of the initial values. And so we have this constraint that the value that a process decides must be one of the initial values that process started with. And the third property is termination, that you want processes to eventually decide on some value. And so this picture, this figure depicts the consensus problem. And you have here five processes, P1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And you have a little arrow here. To the left of the arrow, I've shown the initial value of each process. And so process P1 has an initial value of 2. process, let's say P3 has an initial value of 4, process P4 has an initial value of 2, and process P5 has an initial value of 3. And process P2 had an initial value of 4, but in this particular case, P2 has suffered a crash failure. And to the right of the arrow, we have the decision value or the output value of each of the processes. And so P1 decides 4, you can see that P3 decides 4, P4 decides 4, and P5 decides 4. And P2 doesn't decide because P2 crashes. So this is the problem, and the goal is to design an algorithm that will solve this problem. Given this initial input, one for each process, processes need to decide such that these properties hold. And in order to solve this problem, processes are allowed to communicate with each other in the round model that I just presented. So in the first round, process will send a message, P1 sends a message to whomever it wants, process P2, and so forth. They receive messages and so forth. And the question is, how do you solve consensus in a setting like this where processes may suffer crash failures? This slide just shows that there is a variant of the consensus problem that is called the uniform consensus problem, where the properties are slightly different. So I mentioned to you there's an agreement property where the correct processes, they have to all output the same value or decide the same value. However, that property, the way I define it, allow a crash process to decide on a different value from a correct process. Now, if you think of crash failures, how could that happen, right? If a process crash, how is it going to decide? Well, what non-uniform consensus allows is that a process may value crash, and then other processes execute and they decide a different value. Whereas in the uniform variant, once a process has decided a value before it crashes, that value is fixed, and everybody needs to decide on the same value. And that's the same for the uniform validity property, that not just the correct processes must decide one of the initial values, but all the processes in the system must decide one of the initial values. And so this is a common variant of the consensus problem called uniform consensus. And it turns out that the algorithm that I'm going to give you, well, some of them will be able to solve these stronger variants. So it's clear that if you have a solution for the uniform consensus problem, that solution applies, that algorithm applies as it is to solve the consensus problem, but not necessarily vice versa, because the properties of the uniform consensus problem are stronger than the properties of the consensus problem. But for now, let's just not look at this variant. Let's just look at the regular consensus problem. So if you have a system without any failures, without crash failures, it's very easy to solve consensus. And here I show one such algorithm. The basic idea is that you choose some fixed process. You can think of that process being the leader. And in the first round, all the processes wait to receive the value from the leader. And when they receive the value from the leader, they just decide on that value. And you can see that this very simple algorithm executes in just one round will satisfy all the properties of consensus. In particular, the agreement process property that says that no two correct processes decide differently will hold because every process will decide on the value of the leader, the initial value of the leader. The validity property also holds. Recall that the validity property says that the value that you decide is one of the initial values. But again, in this algorithm, you're just deciding on the initial value of the leader, and so the validity property is also quite easy to see. And finally, the termination property that says that all processes eventually decide also holds because processes decide at the end of round one. So you can see that the consensus problem is really very easy to solve if you don't have any failures in the system, especially in a synchronous system. And the question is, how do you solve consensus now in a system that can have failures? And the answer actually becomes much more complicated now. As we're going to see later, there is no algorithm that will allow you to solve consensus when you have crash failures in just one round. You have to execute across multiple different rounds to do so. And what I show here on this slide is an algorithm that is able to solve consensus in T plus one round. Now, what is T? T is the bound on the number of crash failures that you have in your system. So clearly, if all the processes may crash, then all bets are off. You won't be able to decide anything that way. So we're going to make an assumption that there is an upper bound of at most T failures in a system. And n is the number of processes. And we're going to assume that T is less than n. For example, T equals 1 means at most one process may crash. And this algorithm shows what is the code for each process to execute in each one of the rounds. So each process maintains a set V that is initially contains only the initial value of the process. And then when your process executes a round, it does exactly the same thing for all the rounds. So at the beginning of a round, the process sends its set V to everybody else. Now, the set V is different for each one of the processes because initially the set V has initial value of the process. But in the first round, the process just sends V to everybody. And when a process at the end of the first round receives that set V, it just takes the union of all the messages that it receives, of all the Vs from the other process that it receives, and takes the union with its own V. And so this is the code for round one. For round two, it's exactly the same. Now, for round two, each process will have a slightly bigger V set because it has received the V from the other process. It does exactly the same thing. It sends its V, its new V to everybody, and then receives the Vs, and then takes all the union. So you can think of this as being a flooding algorithm, where basically the processes are flooding their initial values to everybody else. And when they see a new value, in the next round, they send the value to everybody else as well. So the processes execute that algorithm exactly like that for T plus one rounds. And at the end of the T plus first round, the process just decides on the maximum value that it has ever seen, the maximum value in the set V. So this is the algorithm for solving consensus in T plus one rounds. And let's see why this algorithm works. So the validity property of consensus, recall, it means that if a correct process decides on a value V, then V was the initial value of some process. In other words, you cannot decide on values that come out of the blue. And the claim here is that all the values that are added to the set V are initial values of some process. Now, at the end of round T plus 1, you're going to decide on max of V. But because all the values in V are initial values of some process, that implies that you're going to be deciding on the initial value of some process. And in order to prove this claim, you have to proceed by induction. So at the beginning of the first round, you can see that V has the initial value of all each process. The set V at each process has its initial value. So all the values in V are the initial value of some process. And as the algorithm executes, what you do is you take the union of the Vs of the other processes, but the Vs of the other processes only have initial values. And so for all rounds, you can see that V will only have initial values of processes. Now, the termination property is also quite easy to see, because at the end of round T plus 1, according to the algorithm I just described, all the processes are supposed to decide. And so the correct processes will decide in round T plus 1. What is more difficult to show is the agreement property, and we have to show that no two correct processes decide different values. And to show that property, I'm going to rely on the following claim, that there exists a round R between 1 and T plus 1 where no process crashes. And the reason this lemma holds is that you have at most T process crashes. And so if you're trying to put T processes in T plus 1 rounds, there's going to be one round where no process is crashing, right? The second claim I'm going to make is that in this round, special round R, where no process has crashed, all the processes that haven't crashed so far, we end up with the same set V. In other words, if you look at V of process P1, V of process P2, all the alive processes, don't look at the processes that have crashed before, but the processes that are alive in that round, you're going to see the same set V. And the reason for this property is that all the alive processes receive exactly the same round. Now, recall that in round R, there are no crashes. And so there are no processes that will be sending some messages to some process, but not to other processes, because that's what happens when you have a crash. Everybody's executing just fine in round R. So everybody that is alive in that round will send messages to everybody else. And at the end of the round, they're all going to have the same V. And that is irrespective of the V that they had in previous rounds. Now, the next claim that I'm going to make is that after the special round R, where no process crashed, the V of all the processes will remain the same. And it will be the same V that they had at the end of round R. In other words, there's going to be no further values that get added to the set V for any reason, regardless of how many crashes are occurring subsequently. And the reason for this property is that really there is nothing else you can add to a set V, because whatever you're adding to a set V is coming from an alive process. But you already established that all the alive processes in round R have the same V. So what happens is that all the messages, all the values that are in flux in the system from round R subsequently have already been added to set V. And so subsequently, it would be impossible for you to add anything else. Well, therefore, it follows that if you look at what's happening in round T plus 1, which is happens after round R or is the same as round R, all the processes will decide on the same value. Because if you recall the algorithm in round T plus 1, all the processes will decide on the max of their V sets. But it will just establish that the V set is going to be exactly the same from round R onwards, round R, R plus 1, up to round T plus 1. So this shows correctness of the algorithm, but you may be wondering, why do we need to run for T plus 1 rounds? Why don't you just run two rounds, and let's say T equals 10, and make the algorithm decide at the end of the second round, where you would expect that perhaps they're all going to have the same V, they decide on the max of V, and they solve consensus faster. So why are processes executing for T plus 1 rounds? And what I've shown here is a time diagram that shows an execution, a bad execution that would happen if your algorithm tried to decide earlier. If you try to decide at the end of round T instead of the end of round T plus 1, you may get in a situation where different processes may decide different values. And this is exactly the execution where that happens. And there are other executions, but this is just one example. So in this execution, we have five processes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And process P1 is a special process that starts with initial value 1. And all the other processes start with initial value 2. And so in an execution like this, processes are allowed to decide either 1 or 2, because 1 and 2 are the initial values. Now, what happens in round 1 is that the special process P1 crashes, and it manages to send a message only to one process, process P2, which is being shown by this arrow here. So P1 managed to send its V set, which has the value 1, only to process P2. But it crashes, and so processes P3, P4, and P5, they don't see the initial value 1 that process P1 had. So at the beginning of round 2, the situation is that process P2 has seen initial values 1 and 2. Everybody else has seen only their initial values. Well, I have not shown here the messages that are going from the other processes, but there are messages going from P5 to P2, from P4 to P2, from P3 to P2, and so forth. But all these messages carry the exactly same initial value that P2 has. And so at the end of the first round, or the beginning of the first round, P2 will have its V set only the value 2. I'm sorry. P3 will only have the value 2 in its P3 will only have the value 2 in its set V. P2 will have both 1 and 2. It will have 1 because it received the message from P1, and it will have 2 because it started off with value 2 itself. And so P2 has 1 and 2, P3 has only 2, P4 has only 2, and P5 has only 2. What happens in the second round is very analogous to what happens in the first round, but rather than P1 crashing, P2 crashes. And when P2 crashes, it manages to send the value 1 that it has in its set V. So it sends both values 1 and 2, but I'm depicting here only the value 1. It manages to send that message only to process P3. And so what happens is that at the beginning of round 3, only P3 has values 1 and 2 in its V sets. Process P4 and process P5, they only have value 2 in its V set. And so in this case, processes are trying to decide, let's say, at the end of round 3, there's 3 failures, T equals 3. At the end of round 3, processes decide on the max values that they have in their V sets. Well, but unfortunately, process P4 has both values 1 and 2 in its V sets. And so it decides on value 1. Oh, this is an algorithm where the processes are deciding on the minimum of the set. So there's a slight typo here. So the algorithm that I described to you at the end of round T plus 1, process decides on the maximum of value V. This execution shows an algorithm where processes are deciding on the minimum of value V. So this execution actually is not the exact one. I'll fix the slides for you afterwards. But basically, if I had an execution where process P1 is started with 2 and everybody else is started with 1, then at the end of round 3, then process P4 would be the only process that decides 2 and process P5 would have decided 1. Yes?
If
No, this is for crash failures only. And if you have Byzantine failures, I'm going to present an algorithm that solves consensus as well, but it's significantly more complicated. So when you have crash failures, you can have this algorithm where you just send your set V to everybody else. And because you don't have Byzantine failures, you don't have liars in the system. Once you have liars in the system, for example, in this algorithm, you could have process P1 sends one value to process, sends a different value from the other processes, and does so exactly at the very last round when they're just about to decide. And so at the very last round, when processes take the max, they're going to see different values and they're going to decide different values. And so this algorithm would not work with the Byzantine failures. It's designed just for crash failures. Oh, no. So this algorithm is for crash failures where the crashes are permanent. But actually, in this specific case, if the algorithm were, if the process were to come back to life, which is not the model that we consider, the algorithm would still work. But when I'm talking about crash failures, the assumption is that the crashes are permanent in the round model. Another question? Yeah, no, that's a good question. How do you decide the value of T practically, which is the bound on the maximum number of failures? Because once you violate the bounds, then the algorithm is no longer going to work. You can have, in this specific case, processes deciding different values. And what you have to do in practice is to analyze your system and look at the mean time to failures and so forth, and decide what is going to be the probability that your system, and what is the desired probability that your system will do something unexpected. And let's say you choose a probability to be like 0.00015. And then you decide for that probability, and assuming that the failures occur in certain ways. So what is the value of T that I need in order to be sure that with that probability, or with the probability smaller than that, you're only going to have up to T failures, right? And so the long answer to your question is that people have been looking into this, and it's actually an active topic of research, because there are all complications that can arise. Even if you do an analysis like this, that you're assuming that failures occur with a certain probability, you assume that the failures are independent of each other. Well, there may be cases where, for example, everybody crashes at the same time, right? Or everybody but one process crashes at the same time because you have a power failure, or because of the setting where you have a system. You may have a rack, for example, in a data center. Rack goes away, crashes a bunch of processes, violate the assumptions that you had for T. And so it's not an easy question to answer. But what happens in practice is that people typically pick the case for T equals 1 or T equals 2, especially if you have an extremely large system. You're using components that are maybe reliable, maybe not reliable. They're commodity components. But they're still fairly rare to crash. And you assume that you have mechanisms that assure you that you don't have these correlated failures that will kill a lot of processes at the same time. And under all these assumptions, then the algorithm works. If one day if something gets violated, then your system will have an anomalous behavior. Yes, so the short answer to your question is that it's a very hard choice to make, and it's still an active research area. Yes. Yes. Right. It's possible. Well, so if you have a crash failure and the algorithm crashes, the process crashes and remains crashed, well, in this algorithm it works even if the process doesn't remain crashed. What I've shown in the proof is that the algorithm would work nonetheless. And so think of an execution where, let's say, P1 has an initial value of 1, just like shown here, and everybody else has an initial value of 2. And P1 crashes in the first round and doesn't send to anybody, right? So what you're left with in round 2 is all the processes have initial value 2. And after they execute 3 rounds, all the processes will decide on the same value. And so this is an example of a bad execution, where when a process crashes but manages to send a message out, processes will not be able to decide at the end of round 3 because you're trying to decide at the end of round T equals 3. But if so happens that a process crashes and doesn't send a message to anybody, if you assume a model like this, when a crash occurs, and this is called a clean crash, when a process crashes, doesn't send a message to anybody, it is actually easier to solve consensus in such cases. And the reason for this is because there's a consistent view of what is the bad process doing in each one of the rounds, as opposed to P2 sees a message from P1, but P3 doesn't see a message from P1. And so the case that you're asking about is actually easier to solve consensus than the case that we're looking at here, which is more general. But the algorithm that I gave you would work in that case as well. Okay, so I mentioned to you that we need T plus one rounds. You cannot always decide at the end of round T in the algorithm that I gave you, because you can get into situations where processes will decide differently. And the question is there another algorithm that would allow processes to decide faster than in T plus one rounds? And the answer is, well, sometimes, but not always. So I'm going to show you an algorithm that has an early stopping property where the round where processes decide depends on the actual number of failures that have occurred in the system, as opposed to the bound on the number of failures that have occurred in the system. So recall that the value t is the upper bound on the number of failures that it can have. And you choose this parameter, it's fixed. Now t equals 3. But if you have an actual execution, you may be lucky, and there may be zero crashes in that execution. We want such executions that are lucky, that have a small number of failures for processes to decide faster. And this is called the early stopping property. So in other words, if you let f be the actual number of failures that occur in a given execution, we want the decision to depend on the value of f as opposed to the value of t. And f is going to be less than or equal to t. So I'm going to show you one such algorithm that will therefore be able to decide faster than the algorithm that I just showed you. However, in the worst case, when we have f equals t, because t is an upper bound, you can have situations where all the t-allowed failures actually occur, the algorithm that I'm going to show you will take also t plus 1 rounds to decide. And in fact, what I'm going to show you is that any algorithm that tries to solve consensus in a round-based model will have executions where, in the worst case, depending on when failures have occurred, the algorithm will have to decide only at the end of round t plus 1. In other words, there will be some rounds where some executions where the processes decide earlier, but in the worst possible execution, it's going to take t plus 1 rounds for processes to decide. And I'm going to prove to you that that's the case. So before I do that, let's look at the early designing consensus algorithm where processes decide based on the actual number of failures, in a number of rounds that depends on the actual number of failures. So I'm going to give an algorithm where if you have zero failures, no failures at all, processes are able to decide in round one. And if you have f failures, processes will decide in rounds f plus one. Now, in the worst case, f equals t, and so processes will still decide at the end of round t plus one. I should mention to you that this algorithm does solve the uniform version of consensus that I mentioned to you before. It only solves the non-uniform version of consensus. And recall the difference being that in the uniform version of consensus, we require that no two processes decide differently. In the non-uniform version of consensus, you allow a process that crashes to decide a different value from a process that doesn't crash. And again, how can that happen? Because the process may decide a value and then crash. And then subsequently, other processes decide on a different value. So the algorithm that I'm going to give you has this possibility that a process decides a value, crashes, and other processes decide on a different value. Later, I'm going to show an algorithm that satisfies the uniform version as well, but that algorithm takes an additional round to solve consensus. In other words, with zero failures, processes will decide in round two instead of round one. And with f equals t failures, well, there is an optimization that allows the process to decide at the end of round t plus one. But in general, if you have f failures, then processes will decide in round f plus 2. So let's look at the simpler non-uniform consensus algorithm first. So let's look at the property of a system first. Let's suppose that C is a correct process. So the first observation I'm going to make is that if C receives all the messages from all the processes in round one, and think of the algorithm that I just gave to you, where you're just flooding the messages, everybody sending their sets V to everybody. So in that algorithm, if C receives messages from all the processes, it learns the initial value of all the processes in the system. Now, if C learns the initial value of other processes in the system, it kind of knows there's nothing missing there. And so the intuition here is that C will be able to decide at the end of round one, because it has seen all the processes, just pick the maximum of these values. And it's going to rely on the fact that the other process in the system will be able to see all these values as well and decide exactly in the same way. So notice that if C does that, receives all the messages, decides at the end of round one, and C doesn't crash, that means that in round two, C manages to send all the values that I've seen to everybody else. And everybody else will receive those values, and it will have like the full V, and it will be able to decide on the same value. Now, there's a situation that may happen that C decides, receives all these initial values, decides on the maximum, but it crashes later. Before it's able to tell everybody else what is this entire V set, what is the entire set of initial values. Well, this would allow this behavior where a process which is not correct decides differently from a process that is correct, but we don't care about this. In the non-uniform version of consensus, we only want the correct processes to decide on the same value. The second observation I'm going to make is that suppose that now we're not looking into round one, but we're looking at two consecutive rounds, rounds K and K plus one. So that could be, for example, rounds one and two. And suppose that process C receives the same set of messages in round K and in round K plus one. So my claim is that in this case, C is going to receive messages from all the processes that are alive in round K plus one at the beginning of round K plus one. And if that's the case, then intuitively, C has all the values that are surviving, that can only be possibly sent from this point onwards among all the other processes. And so the reason why this observation holds, that C receives from all brain centers of round K plus one, is, well, just think about what's happening in round K plus one. Right? Suppose that there is a sender in round K plus one that C doesn't receive a message from, right? Well, the assumption is that C is receiving a message from the same set of processes in round K and K plus one. But if it's receiving from the same set of processes, you cannot have this process in round K plus one that doesn't manage to send a message to process P. Because that process, if it didn't send a message in round K plus one, it would not have sent a message in round K either. But if it didn't send a message in round K, this process is going to send a message to nobody in round K plus one. Right? And so these are the two good cases that our algorithm is going to take an advantage of. So in round one, if it sees a message from everybody, the process can decide in round one. And if you have two consecutive rounds and the process realizes that it has received exactly the same message from exactly the same set of processes, then the process can decide. Yes? No, absolutely, yes. So the process... Yes, there are versions of this problem where you don't know the set of participants in the system. And there are also versions where, so in this variant, we're also assuming that we know the names of the other processes. So when you receive a bunch of messages, you're receiving from different processes, and you know that this message was received from process one and two and so forth. There's variants where you receive a bunch of messages and you even know who those messages are coming from, where you have anonymous processes. And these variants are being considered in recent published works by various authors, and so it's not, I wouldn't consider that to be a... Oh, in this particular algorithm, that's the case, yes, but I'm mentioning this model, when you receive a message, then you know all the specific senders. But I agree, in this algorithm where you're just flooding the set of messages, you don't need to know who is sending the message. In the algorithm that I'm going to give you for Byzantine failures, which is coming up next, then you have to know exactly the process that is sending you the message. There's another question? Well, if you don't know the number of nodes in the system, then you wouldn't know for the early stopping version. You don't know if you receive the all messages that were supposed to be sent to you in the system. But for example, let's suppose that you receive 5 messages, right? But you don't know if there's 20 processes in the system or 30 processes in the system. And so you wouldn't be able to infer that you received all the messages that were intended to you in the first round if you don't know the number of processes. Sorry, one question at a time, please. Oh, absolutely. I mean, if you get the same set in the first and the second round, you can decide. But what happens if you receive, in the first round, you receive 10, in the second round, you receive 11, and then you receive 12, and so forth, and the number is growing, right? And so let me hold off a little bit for the question. Let me finish the description of the algorithm, because I think the questions are arising because of the fact that I haven't fully described the behavior of the algorithm yet. And then I'll answer any further questions that you may have. So in this algorithm, the behavior is that if you have 0 crashes, then a correct process sees that it has received all the messages and it's able to decide in the first round. And this is the first observation that I made in the previous slide. If you have 1 crash in the system, then what's going to happen? Well, if the crash occurred after the first round, in the first round, all the processes are going to receive a message from everybody, so they're going to decide in the first round. If the crash occurred in the first round, what's going to happen? Well, that means that in the first round, either a process receives all the values, in which case it decides in the first round, or it receives all the values minus 1. Now, if it receives all the values minus 1 in the first round, there's only 1 crash allowed. In the second round, it's going to receive all the values minus 1 as well. And so you have this pattern where the set of processes from which you receive a message is the same in the first and in the second round. So if you have 1 crash, process will be able to decide at the end of the second round. And this is what I've shown here in the table. So if you have a process C which is correct, in the first round it receives n values, then it decides in round 1. It receives a value from everybody. In the first round, if it receives n minus 1 value, then in the second round it has to receive n minus 1 values as well, because there's only 1 crash failure allowed. And when a process crashes, it remains crashed. Now, what happens if you have 2 crashes in the system? And so in the first round, the process may, let's say, receive n minus 1 values. In the second round, well, if it receives n minus 1, it decides. If it receives n minus 2 because another process has crashed, then in the third round, it's going to receive n minus 2, and it's going to decide at the end of the third round. So you can see that in general, if you have F crashes in the system, processes will be able to decide at the end of round F plus 1. And this table is showing the various possible executions as far as C is concerned, how many messages C is receiving. And basically, in the algorithm that I give you, if you want to delay the execution for as long as possible, what you need to do is, in the first round, well, you cannot have all the messages being received, because otherwise the process will decide in the first round. So you need to have 1 message missing, let's say. In the second round, if you have 1 message missing, the process will decide, and so you need to have 2 messages missing, or more than 1 message missing, and so forth. But as soon as you have 2 rounds where the number of messages missing is exactly the same, the process will decide at the end of that round. And so the question is, how long can you postpone this for? And the longest that you can postpone this for is basically by having each round missing an additional message compared to the previous round. And you can do this for, if you're going to have F failures, for F rounds. And then in the F plus first round, you're going to be repeating that value, and then process will be deciding at the end of the F plus first round. Okay, why don't we take a break now? It's already 10:04 for 2 minutes, and we'll continue talking about the uniform version of this problem. If you have any questions, feel free to come up front here and ask me, so I'll be available for questions during the... Let's continue with the... So the algorithm that I just gave you doesn't solve uniform consensus, because a process may decide a value crash and everybody else decides differently. It turns out that there is a way for processes to solve uniform consensus by spending 1 additional round. And the basic idea is that you take the algorithm that I just gave you, you let processes wait for another round. So they're about to decide, but instead of deciding, they just send a message to everybody in an additional round, and then decide at the end of the next round. and that would solve uniform consensus. I won't go into details here, but that's basically how it works. So what I've shown you here is that if you're trying to solve consensus in a synchronous system in the round-based model, I've given you a very simple algorithm where correct processes can decide at the end of round T plus 1. It always does so, and that was the first algorithm that I mentioned. I also gave you an early design version of the algorithm where processes decide in a round that depends on the actual number of failures, F, rather than the upper bound, T, on the number of failures. And in fact, in that algorithm, processes decide by round F plus 1. And there's also a variant of this algorithm where it takes one additional round if you want to solve the uniform consensus variant of the problem. So now I'm going to address the question of, can we do better in the worst case? The algorithm that I just gave you, which is the early deciding one, in the worst case, F equals T. And so it's going to still take T plus 1 rounds for processes to decide. And the question is whether we can come up with a better algorithm that guarantees decision by round T in every possible execution or not, because if you could, that algorithm would be better, faster. And the answer is no, because I'm going to show you a lower bound result that shows that no matter what algorithm you come up with, there's going to be an execution of that algorithm where processes will decide after round T. So in other words, it's going to take at least T plus 1 rounds in the worst case for the algorithm to decide. And I'm going to give you the proof now. So suppose that A is an algorithm that can solve consensus. We're going to make some assumptions on these algorithms without loss of generality. First one, that the algorithm is solving binary consensus. Now, what is binary consensus? It's a version of consensus where the initial value of processes is limited to being either 0 or 1. The reason why I can make the assumption is that if you have an algorithm that solves the general version of consensus, your algorithm will also solve the binary version of consensus in which the input value is restricted to 0 or 1. And so I'm going to be making that assumption that you're solving that problem. The other assumption that we're making without loss of generality is that in each round, there is at most one process that crashes. So in other words, you don't have in a round two processes crashing. The reason why I can make this assumption is if you have an algorithm that works in the general case, where multiple processes can fail in a given round, it's also going to work in a situation where you happen to be lucky and only one process fails per round. But we're going to be making that assumption in the proof. Third assumption we're going to make is that the algorithm A is loquacious, meaning that in every round, the algorithm sends a message to everybody. And the reason we can make this assumption is that if the algorithm did not send a message, you can just put a message there, which is a new message. And the recipients of the new message, when they see that message, just ignores the message, doesn't do anything with it. So these are the three assumptions about the algorithm. And I'm going to define a configuration C to be the state of every process in the system at a given time, either the beginning or the end of the round. So a configuration C includes for each process the current round in which the process is executing, which is the same for all the processes, whether the process has crashed in that round or not, and also the internal state of the algorithm that you have, which is solving consensus. For example, if your algorithm keeps a set V, then the configuration has the value of V for each one of the processes. If your algorithm keeps different variables, then the configuration would have the value of all these variables for each different process. In a configuration C, you can think of being a snapshot of what's happening entirely. So C is not a configuration for one process, it's a configuration for all the processes at a given point. A single configuration has the state of all the processes. Okay, now this is a key notion in the proof, is the notion of valency, bivalency, and univalency, which is at the heart of this lower bound proof. And this notion of valency is actually quite interesting, and it's used in other proofs as well. As we're going to see tomorrow, the famous Fischer-Lynch-Patterson result also uses a notion of valency to show the impossibility of consensus. But for today, we're going to use the notion of valency to show the lower bound of T plus 1 rounds for you to solve consensus in a round-based synchronous model. And what is this notion? This notion is a configuration C, which has just been defined previously, is called zero valence, where zero is this initial value of process. You know, process can have an initial value of zero or one. So a configuration C is zero valent if, starting from this configuration C, the only possible decision that process can have is zero. So in other words, you can think of a zero valent configuration as one in which the consensus decision has already been reached. The only possible decision is zero. But processes may not know about that yet. So here's an example of a zero valent configuration. So consider the initial configuration of the system before anybody starts executing. So in that initial configuration, the only thing that you have, well, all the variables of process have their initial value, the initialized value of these variables, and each process has their own initial value. But let's suppose that in this execution, all the processes have for their initial value the value zero, but they haven't executed yet. But everybody has an initial value of zero. So in some sense, destiny is such that zero is the only possible decision, no matter what's going to happen in the execution. Processes don't know yet that zero is the only possible decision. But once they start executing the algorithm, they'll be communicating messages to each other. They realize that the initial value of all the processes is zero, and eventually they're going to decide zero. But from the beginning, once the initial value of all the processes is zero, the decision has already been determined. So if there was some, think of omniscient or some god that would be able to look at your system and see the state of all the processes at the beginning of the execution, that entity would be able to say, yes, no matter what happens in the execution, all the processes will decide zero. And so this is a notion of a configuration being zero valent. The decision has already been reached. Processes may not have yet decided. And similarly, you have the notion of a configuration being one valent, meaning that one is the only possible decision value. In other words, in every possible continuation of the execution from that configuration, processes can only decide one. And that means that, in some sense, one has already been decided. Processes don't know yet. Eventually, they're going to reach and learn about that. And so we have the notion of zero valence, the notion of one valence. And I'm going to use the term univalent to mean that a configuration is either zero valent or one valent. So univalent means the decision has already been determined, but processes may not know about it. It may be either zero or one. And we're going to say that a configuration is bivalent if it's not univalent. What that means is that from that configuration, there are ways to continue the execution in a way that processes will decide zero. And there are also different ways to continue the execution in a way that processes will decide one. As an example, if you have, as I mentioned to you before, in a configuration where all the processes have initial value zero, that initial configuration is zero valent. In other words, it's univalent. And the same for one. It's going to be one valent or univalent. Before I move to the next slide, let me give a specific example of an initial configuration which is bivalent. And this will depend on the exact algorithms and what the algorithm is doing. But think of the first algorithm that I mentioned to you that decides in round t plus 1, that decides the max of v. And consider a situation where at the beginning, process p1 has value 1, and everybody else has value 0. If you have an execution where p1 crashes from the beginning and doesn't send a message to anybody, then at the end of round t plus 1, nobody will ever see the value 1, and so they will all decide 0. So in other words, from that initial configuration, there exists a run or an execution where processes will decide 1. On the other hand, if you have an execution where P1 is correct and manages to send this 1 to everybody in round 1, then processes will decide 1. Yeah, bivalent means it's not univalent. So in other words, there are executions that continue and process decide zero, and there are executions that continue from that configuration where processes decide one. In other words, I mentioned to you that univalent means that the decision has already been determined and processes don't know yet. Bivalent means that the decision hasn't been determined, and there are ways to continue the execution where processes will decide one, and there are other ways where processes will decide zero. And that is the notion of a bivalent configuration. And this notion is extremely interesting. And this is the heart of the proof in session. I'm going to use the notion of bivalency to show that you need to execute, in the worst case, plus one rounds. There's another question here.
Yeah, so in a
Yeah, and so the question, you can say that there's some process that may have decided and then crashed, and the question is, what happens with the other processes? Because if you have the non-uniform version of consensus, the other processes may decide differently. And so, in general, if you have a configuration where a correct process has already decided, then the configuration is going to be univalent, because that is the only possible decision value. But if you have a configuration where some process has decided but it has crashed, then that configuration is going to be bivalent, because, well, it may be bivalent in some cases because other processes may decide differently, especially the non-uniform version of consensus. So for simplicity in this proof, I'm going to show you we're going to consider the uniform version of consensus where, so there are proofs that show you that you cannot solve consensus in T plus one rounds, whether you're trying to solve uniform consensus or whether you're trying to solve regular consensus, non-uniform consensus. I'm going to make an assumption for simplicity that we're trying to solve the uniform version of consensus. And so what that means is that if some process has decided a value and then it has crashed, that value is going to be, that configuration is going to be univalent. So in particular, if P1 has decided 0, crashed, it's going to be 0 valent, because in the uniform version of consensus, everybody has to decide 0. And this is just a simplification for this proof, but there are proofs that actually are able to show you that even the non-uniform version of consensus requires T plus 1 rounds. So I'm going to make the claim that, notice that first of all, if all the initial values are 0, the initial configuration is 0 valent. If all the initial values are 1, the initial configuration is 1 valent. I'm going to claim now that there exists some initial configuration which is not the ones which is all zeros, or not the one which is all ones, that is going to be bivalent. And in order to show this, we're going to proceed by contradiction and assume that all the initial configurations are univalent. In other words, from the get-go, the decision is already being determined, but processes don't know the decision yet. Well, if it is the case that all the initial configurations are univalent, then each initial configuration is either 0 valent or 1 valent.
So are you trying to agree on the minimum value
here? We're looking at any consensus algorithm. And so, yeah, if you have an algorithm that decides on the minimum value or on the maximum value, for that algorithm you have one notion of a configuration being 0 valent or 1 valent. Oh no, so everybody starts with an initial value of 0, no matter what your algorithm does, because of the validity property of consensus, that configuration is going to be 0 valent. Yes. Well, that depends on the algorithm. So if you have a specific algorithm where, let's say, I don't think there is any algorithm where if your value is initially 0, but everybody else has an initial value of 1, for example, that configuration will be 0 valent, because you can crash from the beginning. Nobody else can know that you have a value of 0. They would all decide 1. Yeah, the configuration consists of the state of every process in the system, not just a specific process in the system. And so when I talk about an initial configuration, we're looking at the initial state of all the processes executing. Oh, absolutely, yeah. But the only assumptions that I'm making are the three ones that I mentioned before, that the algorithm is solving binary consensus, that you have one failure per round at most, and that the algorithm is loquacious, because it sends in every round, it sends to everybody. But we're not making any other assumptions about deciding on the minimum or the maximum or any other assumptions like that. So the current lemma that we're trying to show is that some initial configuration is bivalent, and we're proceeding by contradiction. Assume that all the initial configurations are univalent. If they're all univalent, they're either 0 valent or they are 1 valent. Now, we know that the initial configuration for this given algorithm A, where every process starts with 0, is going to be 0 valent, which is shown here. Let me find my point. This seems to be out of battery. So this configuration here, example, initial values of processes are all zero, are zero valent. This one is one valent. And we're making the assumption that anything which is in between, and I'm showing here configurations where P1 starts with one, initial configuration P2 has zero, P3 has zero, and all the other processes have zero. I'm showing you another initial configuration where P1 starts with an one, P2 starts with an one, but everybody else starts with a zero. In another one where P1, P2, and P3 starts with a one, and everybody starts with a zero. So what I'm doing here is I'm having a bunch of different initial configuration where I'm slowly transitioning from all zero configurations to the all ones configurations. And I'm asking the question, what is going to be the situation, the valency situation for each one of these initial configurations? We're assuming by contradiction that each one of these configurations is going to be either zero valent or one valent. Now, on one hand, we know that at the top we are zero valent, and at the bottom we are one valent. And each one of these guys is going to be either zero or one. What that means is that I'm going to be able to find two consecutive lines where the valency changes from being zero valent to one valent. And in this particular picture, this happens between lines 3 and line 4. It may be a different case. Maybe the switch from 0 to 1 happens between lines 1 and 2. Or maybe there are several different such transitions. For example, from 1 to 2, you change from 0 valent to 1 valent. And then from 2 to 3, you change back to 0 valent. I only care about one such transition. Let's just look at one such transition, let's say happening between the lines 3 and 4. It's changing from 0 valent to 1 valent. And these are called neighboring configurations because the difference of these configurations occur only at the value of one process. And the specific example that I give here is only process P3 knows about the difference between these two configurations. Now, this is a funny situation because we're designing an algorithm that should tolerate failures. And P3 is the only process that knows the difference between these two neighboring configurations, one of them being zero valent and one of them being one valent. But it may be the case that P3 just crashes without ever executing any steps. And a notion of zero valent means that the decision has already been determined to be zero, and one valent has already been determined to be one. But the only process that knows the difference is not able to talk to anybody because the process has crashed, and it is a contradiction. And so this is exactly what I'm showing here. So we have these two neighboring configurations. One of them is zero valent, the other one is one valent. Well, if this configuration is zero valent, I can consider an execution from this initial configuration where the process P3 has crashed at the beginning. And by definition of a zero valent configuration, all the processes have to decide zero in this case. We look at this other initial configuration that is exactly the same as before, but P3 starts with a one. Now, this configuration we said is one valent, meaning that any execution from that configuration, no matter what happens, processes have to decide one. But if P3 happens to crash at the very beginning, in particular, process will still have to decide one. And this cannot happen, possibly happen. And the reason is because these two different executions that are happening, the state of all the processes are going to be exactly the same. So all the processes will send exactly the same set of messages. They receive exactly the same set of messages because the only difference between these two configurations is in the state of P3, but P3 has crashed at the beginning. So this gives you the contradiction that you're looking for, that it's impossible for you to have all the initial configurations being univalent. It implies that there exists some initial configuration which is bivalent. So I think I mentioned this before, but here's an example of a bivalent initial configuration. It really depends on what algorithm you're considering. But in the first algorithm that we looked at, where the set process decides on the max of the set V around T plus 1, this initial configuration where P1 starts with 1, everybody else starts with a 0, would be bivalent. OK, so we're looking at the valency of the beginning. And we've shown that there exists some configuration which is bivalent. Now, let's look at what happens in round T. And my claim is that at the beginning of round T, the configuration has to be univalent. If it's not univalent, then processes won't be able to decide at the end of round T. And so what we're making is the assumption that we have an algorithm A, and A somehow is better to is able to reach decisions faster than T plus 1 rounds. And let's say it's able to reach decision in T rounds or fewer than T rounds. Well, I'm going to make this claim that for this algorithm, at the beginning of round T, the configuration is going to be univalent. Well, by contradiction, suppose that it's bivalent. So So let's see with the configuration at the beginning of round T. Let me make an observation here. First, if processes have already decided, any process has already decided by the beginning of round T or before, that means that the configuration has already been determined, because in this simplifying proof, we are assuming the non-uniform, uniform version of consensus where processes have to always decide on the same value regardless of whether they crash or not. And so processes, if the configuration is bivalent, it's not possible that a process has decided by the beginning of round T. But we're assuming that they're going to be deciding with up to T rounds. So they're going to be deciding at the end of round T. So let's look at the configuration at the beginning of round T. And there's one round left for us to decide, which is exactly round T. Let's consider an extension of that configuration, which we're assuming to be bivalent, an extension of that configuration by one round, where no failures have occurred. And so, in other words, all the failures that have occurred have already occurred in previous rounds. And let's suppose that this configuration, this execution that results from executing one additional round from C, leads to a configuration which is zero valent. Because after all, processes will have to decide at the end of round T. If we're assuming that this magical algorithm exists that decides only in T rounds, and if they set a value, they're going to decide either zero or one because this is binary consensus. We're making the assumption without loss of generality that they're going to decide zero, and therefore the configuration, the resulting configuration, is going to be zero valent. But if process happens to decide one, the proof is going to be exactly the same as the proof that I give here, but you have to switch zeros and ones. Now, since configuration C is bivalent, there exists another way to continue the execution in round T, such that we get to a new configuration that would be one valent instead of being zero valent. And I'm going to call that the continuation from the execution that continues from configuration C, the execution R1. So in other words, from C, we have the execution of round T. Nobody crashes, we decide zero. And we have an execution where somebody will have to crash because the execution has to be different from the previous one, and the process will decide one. And I'm going to show you that that leads to a contradiction. And the question is, we know what R0 looks like, nobody crashes, and what does R1 look like? Well, we're making the assumption that there's at most one crash per round. And so in R1, what happens in round T is that there's going to be some process, P2, let's say P2 crashes, and fails to send messages to some other processes. Because if P2 didn't crash, that execution R1 would be exactly like the execution R0 in each process you decide zero. And so in execution R1, P2 fails to send a message to some subset of processes, Q, and it crashes. And there are two possible cases. Either Q is the empty set or Q is not the empty set. Let's look at the case where Q is not the empty set. And so what happens in round T is that P2 manages to send a message to some of the processes, but not to all of the processes, and then crashes. And what happens is that the configuration is going to be one valent, but because we're assuming that decision takes only T rounds, processes have to decide at the end of round T. And so all the processes that get these messages should decide one. And this is a typo, by the way, because this process cannot decide if it has crashed. OK. But notice there is one thing very fishy going on here. If you look at what's happening with process P1 in round T, process P1 in run R0 has received a message from process P2 and has decided the value 0 and has received a message from other processes as well. And this is the one where nobody has crashed. In this one where P2 has crashed, process P1 is receiving exactly the same information, is receiving the same message that P2 sends in this run, and is receiving messages from all the other processes. So in this run, R1, P1 would behave exactly the same as in this run, R0, and therefore it would decide 0. And so we have a contradiction to the fact that we're assuming that this run, R1, is one valent, and process decide one. Yes? P2 was sending a bunch of messages here, right? And some of them got delivered, some of them didn't get delivered. Yeah. Oh, okay. No, we're making the assumption that when a process sends a message in a round, it sends one message, at most one message, to each one of the processes. Now, if your algorithm, if you think about it, wanted to send two messages, you can just pack those two messages together in the same message and just send one message, right? And this is a property of the round-based model, that a process sends one message to each one of the other processes. But as I just said, if you have an algorithm where you send multiple messages, you can just pack them together into a single message. What's that, sir? Oh, I didn't hear what you said. Is implemented from the message chain? Yeah, it's an assumption about the model of execution, the round-based model. Each process sends one message to each other processes. Oh, yeah, I don't know. So you're concerned about like a gigantic message that may not be carried on by the network and so forth. Yeah, we're assuming a higher level of abstraction where maybe in the underlying network, your message has to be split into multiple fragments and be in order to implement this abstraction. But as far as the abstraction is concerned, the process sends one message. And then when it receives the entire package. Now, if it were to receive some of the fragments but not the others, the message would get dropped. Right? Yes. The final step of decision? Yeah, it doesn't have to be deterministic, but as far as this proof is concerned, you can assume that it's deterministic. Because if it's not deterministic, that brings the question of what is the correctness of your protocol when you have non-deterministic steps. And the correct way to define this is that your algorithm has to produce a correct behavior no matter what are the non-deterministic choices. And once you've accepted that, then you can just constrain yourself at looking at an algorithm that is completely deterministic. So you pick one of the deterministic choices. Now, if you have several choices, just pick one of them and you go with that. Right? I'm saying, if you have a non-deterministic algorithm, it's going to be more complicated for the algorithm to reach agreement than if you have a deterministic where the algorithm is always behaving in an expected way, given the set of messages that it receives. Right? So this was the case where set Q is not empty. So when set Q is not empty, we're able to find this process P1 that receives a message in runs R1, receives a message in runs R0, but in one case decides 0, in the other case decides 1, which is a contradiction. But it's possible that the set Q of messages that P2 sends is empty. In other words, P2 crashes and doesn't send a message to anybody. And this is the next case that we look at. So we have run R0, no failures. We have run R1, P2 crashes, doesn't send a message to anybody. In this case, we can create another run, and we're going to call this run R2, in which we put back the message that P2 didn't send. P2 didn't send a message to anybody, but we put back this message. P2 sends a message to P1, and we look at what happened. What would have happened in this execution where P2 crashes in round T, manages to send a message only to P1, doesn't send a message to anybody else. So from the point of view of P1, P1 receives a message from P2, it receives all the other messages from the other processes. This execution looks exactly as in execution R0. And in execution R0, P1 decides 0. Now we look at another process, let's say P3, that didn't get a message from process P2. And this execution looks exactly the same as execution R1, in which P2 didn't manage to send a message to anybody. And in execution R1, we're assuming it was one violent, process decide 1. And so over here, process P3 would also decide 1. And so we have an execution where some processes have decided 0, some processes have decided 1. That violates the agreement property, the uniform agreement property. And that gives us the contradiction in the case where set Q is empty. So what I've shown here is two properties. First, there exists some initial configuration which is zero valence. And at the beginning of round T, all the configurations are univalent. What I'm going to show you next is that we have this configuration C0, which is bivalence. In this configuration, this is the beginning. There's no rounds have been executed. We can extend that configuration by one round. We can execute one round and maintain the configuration in a univalent situation. Now, in order to show this property, we may have to crash a process in the first round. But what this property will give you is that processes will have executed one round. And at the end of round one, which is the beginning of round two, the configuration was still going to be bivalent. and possibly one process has crashed. And in fact, I'm going to show you that you can take that configuration at the end of round 1 or beginning of round 2, which is bivalent, and extend it further by one additional round while still maintaining the configuration bivalent. And you may have to crash another process in the second round to do that. And if you repeat that construction, we're able to execute for T rounds with, well, we can repeat this construction for T plus 1 rounds so that at the end of round T plus 1, the configuration will remain bivalent. So I've just shown you that at the end of round T plus 1, the configuration has to be univalent, because if it's bivalent by the previous proof, it gets us into a contradiction. But if you repeat this construction T plus 1 times, that I'm going to show you, we're able to execute up to the end of round T plus 1 and maintain the configuration bivalent, and that's going to be a contradiction. Now, what's the intuition here? So the notion of bivalence means configuration, the decision hasn't yet been determined. So we've shown that there's some initial configuration where the decision is not yet determined. We're going to show that it's possible to keep extending this one round at a time for T plus 1 rounds so that the decision has not yet been determined. And we can do this for up to T minus one rounds. And then we get to the end of round T plus 1, the decision has not yet been determined. This contradicts the fact that if you're trying to decide by round T, you need the decision to be determined by the end of round T plus 1. Okay, so this is the exact property. So if C is a configuration which is bivalent and has fewer than T rounds, then we can extend C by one round and obtain another bivalent configuration. So in order to show this property, we're going to proceed by contradiction again. Suppose that we're starting at C, which is bivalent, and every one round extension, if you run it for the algorithm for one extra round, we're going to get into a univalent configuration. Look at, again, a configuration at zero where we extended C by one round, but no failures have occurred. And that configuration is going to be, we assume it's going to be univalent. It's going to be either zero valent or one valent. And we can assume without loss of generality that R0 is zero valent. In the other case, where R0 is one valent, would have been analogous. We can just switch zeros and ones in the proof. Now, because we're assuming that C is bivalent, we can find another way to extend the configuration by one round in which the configuration is going to be one valent. And we're assuming that any ways to extend it, we're going to get into univalent, which is either zero or valent. If all the ways to extend are zero were zero valent, then C would have been zero valent to start with. But the fact that C is bivalent means there are ways for you to extend C in ways that will be both zero valent and one valent. And we're going to call the run R1 this one round extension of C that gets you to a one valent configuration. Another question is, what does R1 look like? We know what R0 looks like. There are no failures in the specific round where processes are executing. And here, I show you what happens in run R1. And we're assuming that R0, where no failure is zero valent, R1 is going to be one valent. Well, R1 has to be different from R0 in some way. Some process has crashed. We're assuming there's at most one process that crashes per round. And in this case, the process is this distinguished process Q. And Q will fail to send messages to some of the processes. Maybe it sends a message to P1, but not to P2 and P3 and P4. And the proof here is going to be similar to the proof that I've just given you about the case when you have T minus one rounds and the configuration has to be univalent there. So what we're going to consider is several neighboring configurations that basically go from run R0 to run R1 and differ only by the state of one process. So what we're going to do here is we're going to take this run R0 with no failures. We're going to take this process Q, and we're going to crash a process Q, and we're going to start removing the messages that Q sends to the other processes one at a time. And so specifically, we consider first a run which we call S1, which is just identical to R0. We consider another run that we call S2, which is identical to R0, except that Q has crashed and has failed to send one message. We look at another one in which Q has crashed and has failed to send two messages and so forth, until we get to the run SK, which is equal to the run R1, where Q queue has crashed and has failed to send the message is exactly the message that it failed to send in run R1. Yes. Oh, yeah, so the question is why are we calling this one valent, right? So we're proceeding by contradiction. We want to show that if C is zero valence, there's a way to extend the execution by one round such that you remain bivalent. So C is bivalent, we execute by one round, and we remain bivalent. Now, assume by contradiction that's not the case, which means that you execute by one round, and you end up being either zero valent or one valent. Now, we know that the failure-free extension, where no failures have occurred, is going to be, let's say, zero valent. It could have been one valent. Let's suppose it's zero valent. And we know that C is bivalent, meaning that there is continuations from C where process is the side one. That means that, well, we're assuming that every continuation is not going to be bivalent, which is going to be zero valent or one valent. That implies that because C is bivalent, there will be continuations where continuations from C where the configuration is going to be one valent as well. Notice that if all the possible continuations from C were zero valent, then C would have been zero valent to start with. But the fact that C is bivalent means there's continuations that are zero valent, there are continuations that are one valent. And we're assuming that no such configurations are bivalent, right? Does that answer the question? Yeah. Oh, no, it's a proof by contradiction, right? So assume that, and we're going to reach into contradiction. In fact, you can't ensure that the configuration is going to be zero valent. So we want to show that if C is bivalent, we can extend C by one round and remain bivalent. We're assuming by contradiction, no, that's not the case. Every way to extend C by one round is going to be univalent, which means either zero valent or one valent. That means there's this one guy which is zero valent, there's one guy which is one valent. And I'm just taking two of those guys and I'm transitioning the execution from one to the other by making small changes in the execution from each neighboring configuration. And then what we're going to do next in the proof is look at what happens in this configuration where we just change very little from one run to the other, but the configuration transitions from being zero valent to one valent. And so, again, this is a similar argument that we made before. We know that this guy is zero valent. There's this other guy, which is one valent. There's a place where it transitions from being zero valent to one valent, which is right here, let's say. And the difference between these two configurations is that the process Q has managed to send a message to this process here. And over here, it didn't send a message to that process. And if you look at what happens here, well, think about what's going on here. So this process, which managed to receive a message from Q here but not there, is the only process that knows the difference between this execution and this other execution. But this execution is zero valent, meaning that every way to continue this configuration, processes are going to decide zero. So here we have a one valent configuration, meaning every way to continue this execution, processes are going to decide one. But there's only one process that knows the difference. And so the question is, what happens if that process that knows the difference crashes at the beginning of the next round before it can communicate with any other process? Then that process, which is the only process that knows the difference between these two executions, will not be able to tell anybody else. And the question is, how can we have something being zero valent and being one valent? We get to a contradiction. So the specific way to get to a contradiction is to consider a continuation from this configuration where at the beginning of the next round, this process crashes. We consider exactly the same continuation from the beginning of the next round where this process also crashes, doesn't send a message to everybody. We argue that all the processes will execute in exactly the same way. And if they execute exactly the same way, they're going to decide exactly the same value. But that's impossible because in here, the configuration was one valent, and in here, the configuration was zero valent. And so this shows us the dilemma that there exists a way for you to extend a bivalent configuration to another bivalent configuration by executing one extra round. And when you do so, you may have to crash a process. So this basically concludes the proof, right? Because what I've shown here, just hold on this question for a second. What I've shown here is all these properties that C0 starts being bivalent. At the beginning of round T, the configurations are all univalent. But I've shown you that we can, for T minus one rounds, extend the bivalent configuration by one round and get up to the beginning of round T and still being bivalent, which contradicts the property that I've shown you that at the beginning of round T, you have to be univalent. So this shows you that this algorithm that you thought about that could solve consensus in T rounds cannot possibly exist, establish the contradiction. So let me ask a question. You guys are going to have another lecture at 11 o'clock. Is there a break between lectures? So it's about 5 minutes. So I should wrap up probably then.
Yeah.
5-10 minutes. Okay. Let me mention that there is another problem which is closely related to consensus called terminating reliable broadcast. And in this problem, we have a distinguished process S that wants to broadcast a message to everybody else in the system. And all the other processes, they don't have any initial values, and they're just passive processes. And terminating reliable broadcast is this problem where these three properties must hold. First is that if the distinguished process S, which you can think of S as being the sender, if the sender is correct and broadcasts a certain message M, then all the correct processes deliver M. The second property says that all the correct processes eventually deliver some message, which may or may not be the message that was broadcast. For example, if the sender crashes from the beginning, then the processes may deliver a special message called SF, or sender faulty, saying that I don't know what is the message of the sender. And it has the uniform integrity property that a process delivers at most one message, and it only delivers either the message that the sender has, the sender is trying to send, or delivers the sender faulty message. There's also an agreement property that says that all the correct processes deliver the same message. And this is needed for the case where the sender crashes at the beginning. And so you can't have a situation where the sender crashes, some process deliver the message, sender faulty saying, I don't know what the message of the sender is, and other processes that have seen the message of the sender deliver that message of the sender. So pictorially, in terminating reliable broadcast, you have here the special sender process. In this figure, is process P1 has a message M. If the sender doesn't crash, everybody has to deliver M. And if the sender does crash, then processes have two options. Either everybody delivers that message M that the sender has, or everybody delivers the special sender faulty message. The first case might occur, for example, if processes manage to see the message of the sender before the sender crashes. And in the second case might occur if the sender crashes before it's able to tell anybody what its message was. But in general, no, we can have many different algorithms. Maybe the algorithm might require the sender to execute for 3 rounds before its message can be considered by other processes. But in any case, whatever algorithm you come up for this problem, you have to fall into one of these two situations when the sender crashes. And it's possible to show that this problem is equivalent to consensus in the sense that if you can solve TRB, yes, in a synchronous round-based system, if you can solve terminating reliable broadcast, then you can use that as a black box to solve consensus and vice versa. For example, suppose that I have terminating reliable broadcast in a black box, and now I want to solve consensus. How do I do that? Well, the basic idea is to run n different copies of the terminating reliable broadcast algorithm at the same time, where for each copy you have a different sender. And so in other words, each process will use a TRB box in order to try to broadcast its initial value to everybody else. So we're trying to solve consensus. Each process has an initial value. Each process uses the TRB box to broadcast their initial value. And TRB ensures that all the processes are going to deliver exactly the same message from all the other processes. So at the end of this algorithm, you have a vector of outputs from the TRB, one for each TRB instance. And once you have that vector, the TRB definition ensures that the vector that all the processes have are going to have exactly the same components. And therefore, what you can do is you take this vector you look at the first component, which is known, which is not center faulty, and then you decide on that value. And if all the values are center faulty, then, well, that cannot really happen, because that means that all the processes have failed in the system. Okay, so I'm going to skip to the end of this presentation, and let's do this. Tomorrow, we're going to continue about the case of Byzantine failures in synchronous round-based systems. And you will see that tomorrow, it's going to be, situation is going to be considerably more complicated, because when you have Byzantine failures, you can have processes lying about what the values that they have. And if you're trying to solve consensus, things are going to be slightly more complicated. So let me just end here. If you have, I guess, if you have any questions, let me know. All right, thank you.